October 1975. Australia is being drawn relentlessly into a constitutional twilight zone.
We've now the highest unemployment since the Great Depression, the worst prolonged inflation in our history.
So let there be no mistake. The opposition will block our budget. But this government will not be held to ransom. We were elected for 3 years, and we will serve for 3 years.
The opposition will use the power invested in us by the Constitution to delay the passage of the government's money bills through the Senate until the Prime Minister places himself and his government before the people.
I formally move that these supply bills be not further proceeded with until the government agrees to submit itself to the judgment of the people.
The supply bills have been deferred.
With its budget blocked, the government embarks on a course breathtaking in its audacity. It will not call an election. It will continue to govern, even without money. It's a battle of political will, unprecedented in its magnitude. Throughout this constitutional crisis, one man will be its witness, its jury, and finally its judge. That man is His Excellency Sir John Robert Kerr, Governor General of Australia, Knight of the Order of Australia, Knight Grand Cross of the Order of St. Michael and St. George, Knight Grand Cross of the Royal Victorian Order, Queen's Counsel. A former member of the Labour Party, he is the son of a boilermaker, born in the shadow of a coal mine.
Oh, I knew John Kerr when he was a boy, and he was a fine boy. So we always thought he'd go a long way. Not as far as he went, though.
2 years after the events of November 1975, the Queen would grant Sir John a coat of arms, its motto, independence under law. There are those who will say in the bitter years ahead that John Kerr was a traitor to his origins.
Oh, Balmain was the real working class suburb. Everybody was a unionist. Everybody knew everybody else. And we had a great respect for each other as workers.
Even though we knew he was smart and brainy and all that sort of thing, we just never thought he'd get as high as Governor General. Marvellous position to get to, isn't it?
At 8 p.m. on October the 16th, 1975, the Governor General is about to host a viceregal reception for the Prime Minister of Malaysia. In exactly 26 days, in this same room, John Robert Kerr, a man holding no elected office, will change forever the face of Australian democracy.
A toast to our friend and neighbour, Malaysia.
Malaysia.
Australia, may she emerge unscathed.
Thank you, Prime Minister. Australia will emerge stronger. Never again will a Senate dare to defer a government's money bills.
But what if the opposition insists?
It will profit them nothing. The government survives for so long as I have a majority in the people's house.
And when the money runs out, the government's facing bankruptcy, what then?
Let Mr. Fraser explain it. It'll be on his head.
Yes, Sir John.
Well, that's a few weeks away. A lot could happen.
I agree, but assume it doesn't. Both sides are in their bunkers, determined. The people are frightened. Businesses are failing. Chaos.
Well, then the crisis would cease to be political and become truly constitutional.
Exactly. The Governor General would find himself at the very center of it. I wonder, how would he resolve it?
Oh, it's quite clear. By tradition, by all convention, by common sense, the Governor General can act only on the advice of his Prime Minister. That's a fundamental convention of parliamentary democracy.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but under your constitution, the Governor General also has the power to withdraw the Prime Minister's commission, to sack him.
Well, Section 64 does say that ministers hold office during the pleasure of the Governor General.
The so-called reserve powers of the Crown. But they don't apply. Consider if they did. It would mean that the Governor General, as representative of the Queen, would enjoy a power that the Queen herself has never enjoyed.
A right which the British sovereign hasn't had for almost 200 years.
Exactly. And if Her Majesty can't dismiss a Prime Minister, I don't see how a Governor General can. It's absurd.
Gentlemen, you are both a long way down the track. The opposition could change its mind. The Prime Minister could advise an election. There is time enough and good sense will prevail.
But, Sir John, politicians are proud, stubborn men, not given to surrender or retreat.
Well, in that case, it'll depend on who gets to the phone first. Sir John to dismiss me, or me to have the Queen recall him.
Eh? In the weeks ahead, Gough Whitlam's faith in the man he has chosen as Governor General will never falter. Estimable perhaps for its loyalty, it is to be a political mistake of the greatest magnitude.
Whitlam's kept his. He said he wouldn't call an election. And he hasn't.
Not yet, maybe. All he's done is postpone it. No government could stay in office without funds. We keep our nerve. We'll starve him out.
I don't know. Gough's magnificent in a brawl. Take it to the brink.
It'll be up to Kerr.
That's what worries me. Whitlam appointed him. He's Gough's man. Kerr's not likely to go against him.
I wouldn't be too sure about that. I study the man. Look at his history. The only thing he's ever served is the law. He's always gone by the book. Although it's never been used, the Constitution gives the Governor General enormous power. It's up to us to alert him to it. Encourage him to use it.
Mr. Fraser. Mrs. Fraser, Mr. Killen.
Sir.
An old acquaintance. Minister, nice to see you again.
Mr. Prime Minister.
As the leaders take their case to the public, violence erupts, marring Liberal Party rallies in Hobart, Brisbane, and Sydney.
Not afraid. We won't back down. Not now. Not ever. We won't betray the people of Australia.
We will not betray the people of this country. We won't allow assault on the Parliament, on the Constitution, and on democracy itself to go on.
I could be bloody on stuff any time.
I will not yield.
Prime Minister, in recent days, you've made your position quite clear. You've said you won't surrender to the Senate. You've said you stand firm and you won't yield. How, then, do you expect this crisis to be resolved?
Some Liberal Party politicians, some senators, they're not all fascists, you know, have very grave qualms about blocking this budget. In the weeks ahead, we will continue to present the budget bills to the Senate. And I have confidence that the conscience of these men will prevail over expediency.
Well, how long do you expect that to take?
I expect the budget to be passed within a matter of weeks.
Mr. Fraser, of course, says that if you refuse to call an election, then the Governor-General will have a role to play.
The Governor-General can issue writs for an election only on the advice of his government, only on the advice of his Prime Minister,
Must Sir John Kerr follow your advice, whatever advice you give him?
Unquestionably. The Governor-General takes advice from his Prime Minister and from no one else.
And must act on that advice?
Unquestionably. The Governor-General...
There's no tolerance here. He must do
none whatsoever. The Governor-General acts on the advice of his Prime Minister.
That was the Prime Minister in fighting form.
What's the point in having a Governor-General? If that's all the job amounts to, you might as well give Whitlam the title. Let him move in here.
Throughout Australia today, a demonstration of an entirely different nature took place in Sydney. A group of...
For the first time ever, most Australians are forced to question the role of the Governor-General, to consider his constitutional power. There are no easy answers. The position is shrouded in legal definition and conflicting interpretation, overlaid by precedent, convention, and political bias.
I'm very concerned about the speculation in the newspapers. Yeah, editorials, stories, headlines, all telling me what I should and should not do.
I know, John. It's verging on intimidation.
Yes, it certainly is. Makes you think, doesn't it, though? I mean, given the confusion
of the constitutional and legal questions, I wonder, should I consult Garfield Barwick? In his capacity of Chief Justice, of course.
No, I don't think you should. Not at all.
There is a precedent.
Yes, I know, Sir John, but that was 1914. The Chief Justice was one of the Founding Fathers, and it was done with the permission of the Prime Minister.
The situation today is quite different.
Barwick is only one of seven judges on the High Court. His opinion is no more valid than the other six. And besides, some of these matters
may have to come before the full bench for judgment.
Very well, Prime Minister.
I don't want any misunderstanding about this, Sir John, at all.
I am advising you not to consult with Barwick.
Yes. Yes, I understand, Prime Minister.
3 years later, John Kerr will publish his memoirs, writing that by the second week of the crisis, he had come to believe that no comment from him was welcome. Never again, he writes, did I feel I could talk to the Prime Minister. More and more, John Kerr will keep his own counsel, something which the Labour Party will never forgive. They are to accuse him of deceit, of never once indicating he is unhappy about the government's tactics.
Mr. Fraser should stop dead.
In the press gallery, they're saying that on no issue have they ever seen Whitlam so impressive in public, so determined in private.
Fraser does go back into power, there'll be a civil war.
Everyone's blaming them. Nobody understands it. All they know is, watch out, here comes chaos.
I don't know, the Liberals reckon the money's pouring in.
The reporters, most of them privately sympathetic to Labour, are starting to predict Fraser will be forced to back down, his political standing probably damaged beyond repair. Undeterred, the Liberals issue a highly detailed press release setting out the legal and constitutional points on which they have based their case.
Much. Shadow Attorney General reckons Whitlam's treating Kerr like a robot. Says it's obvious any government can't govern without money.
Has anyone told Whitlam?
According to the Liberals, the Governor General has the constitutional right to sack the Prime Minister and appoint someone else. I wonder who.
Sounds like wishful thinking.
This news release, largely ignored by the press, is in fact the cornerstone of the Liberal Party's tactics. It has been drawn up by a former Solicitor General of Australia, eminent lawyer Robert James Ellicott, now the Liberal Party's Shadow Attorney General. His analysis of the situation will prove to be one of the most prophetic documents ever written in Australian political history.
Now, halfway down, you'll see I list the three things which the Governor General, in the proper performance of his duties, can demand to know. One, when is the government likely to run out of money? Two, how does the government propose to carry on after it's run out? Three, how does the government propose to resolve the disagreement between the House of Representatives and the Senate?
You mean he's legally entitled to know all these things?
The Governor General's primary purpose is to preserve the Constitution and maintain the laws of the land.
If the Prime Minister uses means which are unlawful and aren't really going to resolve the situation,
it would be within his power Indeed, it would be the Governor-General's duty to dismiss him and appoint someone else.
Excellent. All we have to do is stand firm, force Whitlam to the wall.
Here's the best part. Kerr's heard about it, and he wants a copy of it.
I doubt if Sir John Kerr... John? Would wish to be anywhere else than at the center of great national events. He is not a man who lacks a sense of history, nor one afflicted with false modesty. In the weeks to come, he will not, of course, be party to the maneuvers, simply the umpire. Australians may well have cause to give thanks for the fact that he is no stranger to the game, nor a man afraid to blow the whistle.
Hear, hear. David, get me the Prime Minister.
Something wrong?
No. I'm just reading the Ellicott opinion. Now, I was just wondering if the government's law officers could rebut the Ellicott case.
And I believe we have overwhelming public support. Every branch in every state has reported a flood of donations, offers of assistance. The unions are behind us. Telegrams and letters are pouring in.
You can count on the people. They know who's to blame.
And with the public behind us, my intention is to maintain the pressure on the Senate. And I have no doubt they are going to crack. Comrades, we have come to a great moment in our history. The Senate's power over the money bills will be broken forever. I have never been more certain of anything in my life as I am today. We are going to win.
Oh, Mr. Prime Minister. I'm sorry to worry you. It's the Ellicott opinion. Yes, I just got a copy of it. It's bullshit, isn't it?
Eloquently put, John. Complete bullshit.
I just thought it might be best if the government law officers gave me their assessment of it.
You know my opinion on that, John. As the Prime Minister, I must remain your sole advisor. Still, I will ask the Attorney General and the Solicitor General to draw up an opinion for me. Then I will be glad to pass it on to you. No, there. That's all right.
Goodbye.
That was the Governor General. Fraser has sent him a copy of Ellicott's opinion.
Oh, you think Fraser was PM already?
$1 silver sign.
Oh, he thinks it's all bullshit. But I... Senator, a word. But I told him that I would get you to draw up an opinion, dealing with it, point by point.
It's odd.
What?
Well, why call Gough out of a meeting just to tell him it's bullshit?
Don't ask me. I'm only the Attorney General.
Despite the crisis, both the business and ceremony of government continue. At Yarralumla on Tuesday, October the 21st, Paul Keating is sworn into the ministry, filling the vacancy caused by the resignation of his friend and mentor, Rex Connor.
Substantial achievement, Paul. The youngest ever minister in a Labour government. Not that there's been that many Labour governments, of course.
Congratulations, Paul.
Thank you, Bill.
Well done.
All the very best for the future, Paul.
Gentlemen.
Oh, gentlemen, just a moment. Would you excuse us? I'd like to have a word with the Prime Minister.
Sir John?
You are convinced you can still resolve the situation politically?
Certainly. My strategy is to force the Senate to a clear-cut vote. Either reject the budget or pass it.
You think deferring the budget is just a device?
It's the only course acceptable to all their senators. Now, we know of at least two, and maybe even five, Liberal senators who would never vote to actually reject a budget. Now, as public outrage grows, these men are going to find the situation unbearable. They are going to crack. John, the Senate is on the brink of an historic climb down.
I see. The financial position, what's happening there?
Well, we're having to be stringent, of course. But even if the money does run out, we'll still be able to continue in office.
Really? In what way?
I am considering asking the banks to advance credit to public servants and government contractors in lieu of wages. Once the budget is passed, the government will return that money directly to the banks.
Would that be legal, Mr. Prime Minister?
A surprising question, John, after all these years. You know that I wouldn't do anything that was illegal.
No, of course not. Just the arrangements seemed a bit cumbersome.
Probably.
There is one thing. I am worried that the people might interpret my silence as vice-regal indifference.
I hope not.
Well, there have been suggestions that I should mediate, intervene to find a solution. The suggestions have gained some currency.
What's your thinking, John?
I suggest, with public knowledge, that I meet the leader of the opposition, so it would indicate to the people my very deep concern.
You are aware that you're not entitled to advice from Fraser.
But that way I would be able to assess Mr. Fraser's determination and also the likely course of events.
I see no problem in your learning at first hand his view of the situation.
Thank you.
Good. Anyway, how are you enjoying the job?
Excuse me, Mr. Prime Minister. Just looking this way, if you wouldn't mind.
Well, it's far more demanding than I thought it would be.
Really?
Thank you very much.
As one day turns to another, the opposition realized that what had been planned as a quick hanging has now become a slow strangulation. Every day, demands for them to pass the budget grow, fueling deep concern among a number of Liberals about their leaders' tactics.
The Liberals, stop your action, reprehensible, stop, surrender, now stop.
Don't blame me, love.
In the days ahead, the dissident Liberals will become more vocal, their role more critical. As for Malcolm Fraser himself, the strain is enormous. With only a small staff and none of the logistical support available to the government, he is working 18, 19, 20 hours a day. A naturally cautious person, he is also chancing his whole career on his assessment of one man.
Now the Canberra crisis. Both sides are sticking to their guns. And tonight's solution to political turmoil seems as far away as ever.
Situation. It hasn't been used before, because it hasn't been used today. This would be beating left on
at all. Any possibility of a double dissolution of Parliament before December 1976
at the full stop after necessary.
He said the government was elected for 3 years, and it would...
Never before have we had such an...
Just a moment. The crowds continue to attend the rallies, call to unify the Labour Party behind its leader.
Would you hang on just a moment? And still Phil, do you mind?
I'm sorry. Number of rowdy emergencies. This one aimed at opposition...
Yes. Well, certainly I will. When? No, 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 that's all right. Yes? Okay, thank you. Good night. It's David Smith. Kerr wants to see me. Tonight.
Before we begin,
You do understand you're in no position to offer me advice of any kind. That is not why I invited you here.
Certainly, Sir John, I understand.
What I wish to learn from you is your assessment of the situation. Is it a political brawl, or are we approaching something far more serious?
With respect, Sir John, I believe we're in the midst of a constitutional crisis.
Really? Why?
Well, Mr. Whitlam states repeatedly that he won't go to the people, and we won't fund the government until he does.
But I've heard that the Senate is going to crack, to use the vernacular.
No matter how fervently Mr. Whitlam may hope, I can assure you that won't be the case.
Well, why do you keep deferring the budget? Why don't you go straight out and reject it? Or are you afraid a number of your senators might refuse?
Not at all, sir. Deferring the budget has great tactical advantages.
Well, in what way?
But if the budget is rejected, it's automatically returned to the House of Representatives. Mr. Whitlam may not have any money, but he does have control of the bills. By deferring the budget, the Senate retains control of the bills.
I understand that you have the budget locked in the Senate.
Exactly. And as you know, we do have a clear majority in the Senate. If Your Excellency is forced to dismiss the Prime Minister and appoint someone else to the position...
Like yourself?
Yes, I am the leader of the opposition. If Your Excellency were to appoint me Prime Minister, I would be in a position to have the budget passed immediately. Unlike Mr. Whitlam, I could find the money with which to govern.
Are you certain about that?
Yes, absolutely.
I see. Well, you may get the money in the Senate, but you won't get the support of the House of Representatives. Mr. Whitlam has the majority there?
Yes, that's right, sir. We'd be defeated on the first vote, which would leave me as new Prime Minister with no alternative but to advise the Governor General to dissolve Parliament and call a general election.
I see. So you're basing your whole strategy on me dismissing Mr. Whitlam and appointing you Prime Minister?
We never intended that to be the case, sir. We always believed that Mr. Whitlam would face the voters.
Nevertheless, it seems to be becoming a pretty big gamble. What makes you think I would dismiss the Prime Minister?
We wouldn't presume to tell the former Chief Justice of New South Wales how to interpret the Constitution. But we do believe the Constitution confers enormous power on the Governor General, and that Mr. Whitlam is determined to test that power.
Thank you. You've made your position very clear.
Mr. Fraser, do you think the Governor General is forced to take some action to stop the meeting, Mr. Fraser? I'm sorry, I have no comment. Could I get... Was there anybody else present at the meeting, Mr. Fraser? No comment. Please, can I get... Please, can I get... Mr. Fraser, can you tell us what went on between yourself and the Governor General?
It was a friendly conversation in which the Governor General asked me for my attitude to the present crisis and a likely course of events.
Mr. Fraser, did the Governor General give any indication of his attitude to the crisis?
Look, you know, it was a private conversation, and I don't want to divulge the details of a private conversation.
Oh, Mr. Fraser,
I'm sorry.
This isn't about the government.
Good night. I'm sorry. Good night.
Was he onside or not?
I don't know. I really don't know. He didn't say anything.
You must have talked about something.
He asked questions, challenged me, made me defend our case. I don't know what he's telling Whitlam, but he certainly wants to hear all the arguments. In a way, we're on trial. But he's treating this as a matter for judgment. What we have to do is to prosecute our case.
Excuse me, excuse me. Who do you think is to blame for this crisis, Labour or Liberal?
The Liberals.
The Liberals. Right, second question. Do you think the opposition should refuse to let the budget pass or not?
No, let it pass.
Now, should the Labour government resign and call an election, or should they continue?
They should keep on going.
They should keep on governing. For sure.
Who would you prefer as Prime Minister, Mr. Whitlam or Mr. Fraser?
Gough all the time.
And throughout most of the country, the message is the same. In barely 2 weeks, in an unprecedented political performance, Gough Whitlam has led his party back from the brink of despair. But more significant still, as the crisis deepens, the crowds rallying to back the government swell. It's a clear indication of a dramatic reversal in electoral support for the Labour Party. Among its embattled members, morale soars. If only you could have heard them. Not only were they going to survive, they were going to win.
It's been a startling result, a stunning result for the Labour Party. According to the highly respected Herald survey, over 70% of Australian voters believe the Senate should pass the budget. And well over half the adult population thinks the Labour government should complete its 3-year term in government. But taken overall, the polls indicate a surge of support for the Labour Party in the current crisis.
The polls prove that Mr. Fraser's insights were nothing more than illusions.
You're not wavering in your stand, then?
No.
Well, there's no chance of you going to an early election in order to resolve the crisis?
No, not a general election, no. Mr. Fraser keeps insisting constantly that the government must face the people. We faced the people in December 1972, we faced the people in May 1974, and now he expects us to face the people in November 1975. Well, how often do we have to do it?
Who'll crack first?
It is not the government that is running away from the public verdict. It is the opposition. But thank you very much for your attention, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, thank you. It seems wherever I go now, I am being cheered to the echo.
Great.
Thank you, Frank. As you are all aware, our faith has been repaid. Our stand vindicated. The public haven't been fooled. They know who the villain is in this drama. So now, more than ever, it is my intention to keep the pressure on, to force home our advantage.
How long have we got, leader? When are we going to run out of money?
Bill?
Well, we've definitely got funds for another month until November the 30th, probably several weeks longer. As you all know, Treasury are working on a plan at the moment which will allow us to continue even beyond that date.
What if they don't crack? Will you recommend a half-Senate election?
Well, certainly that option's open to us, but we wouldn't have to make that decision for at least another 2 weeks.
2 weeks? Bill said we got the money for a month or more.
That's true, but we are required to give 4 or 5 weeks' notice of a poll. So now, due to Christmas, the last practicable date for an election would be December 13th. So, working back from that, if there is meant to be an election this year, it would have to be called on or about November 11th.
The 11th of the 11th. Remembrance Day.
The day they hang Ned Kelly.
They won't hang Gough Whitlam.
Thank you, gentlemen. So the end result is, we have almost 2 weeks before we have to decide. Enough time for an outraged public and a resolute government to crack their nerves. Already, I have been told, chronic depression is rife in the opposition. That bodyguard that you see with Malcolm Fraser is not there to stop someone shooting him, but to stop Malcolm shooting himself.
Thank you. Naturally, I'm disappointed by the polls, but I'm not dismayed. The Labour Party has pitched its case to the public gallery, but it's the man on the bench who'll decide. I will continue to remind Sir John, gently, that The law holds a solution to the deadlock, and we expect him to invoke the law.
You'd better ask him to hurry. Analyze the figures. The ALP vote has increased already by 12%.
As you seem to have studied them so closely, you'll know that we still have enough support to win an election.
Not for much longer.
I don't believe that. I don't believe that polls are an accurate reflection of how people will vote in an election.
That's bullshit.
People are reacting against a threat of chaos. That threat will be removed once an election's called. The people of Australia will cast a vote for the future. You know, forget the polls and the political scientists. Does anyone really believe that Australia will sentence herself to another 3 years of Labour? Are there any questions? Any comments?
I've never known people to be so hostile.
An election is the last thing we need.
What do you think?
I don't know, mate. We're just gonna have to trust him.
Jim, John was just saying that according to the polls, Fraser may be looking for a way out.
He has one. All he's got to do is to pass the budget.
Yes, but then his own survival becomes the problem if he surrenders. I think he's finished as opposition leader. He'll go the same way as Billy Snedden.
Well, he's only got himself to blame. In the past, he has supported every single principle that is now an issue. 7 months ago, on becoming leader, he said the government should serve its full 3 years. 9 weeks ago, he said he was prepared to pass the budget. He fully intended to. And then what happened? He lost his head, and he rushed into this Camlani business. Yes, Sue, please.
Oh, I'm very worried. 3 leaders of the opposition in 1 year is not good for democracy. Mightn't it be to everyone's advantage if we tried to get him off the hook?
How do you mean?
Well, apart from the public backlash, the biggest worry is that they know you're about to call a half-Senate election.
I'm certainly thinking of it. I know it's not due for 6 months, but there are plenty of precedents for holding it now.
Yes, perhaps so, but what with the High Court's decision to allow the territories to elect their own senators, you've got them frightened. You see, they think now that there's a chance that you might have a temporary majority.
Yes.
Yes, and the first thing we do is to pass the electoral redistribution bills and put the Country Party out of business. Anyway, at least that's the theory.
Yes, that's right. Now, isn't there a possibility that we could use this to help Fraser withdraw gracefully?
How do you mean, John?
Well, suppose the government does agree not to hold a half-Senate election till next June, surrendering all chance of a temporary majority, then the opposition could, in return, agree to pass the budget.
It'd let Malcolm say he's achieved something.
A government shouldn't have to bargain with the opposition just to serve its full term.
It was just a suggestion, that's all.
No, I think it's an interesting idea. Are you saying that you want to raise it with Fraser?
Well, if you would agree, yes.
I don't see any harm in raising it. But make it clear, you're just exploring an idea. I don't want Fraser interpreting it as a sign we're weakening. We're not.
Well, still in all, results indicate there's a surge of support for the government. It's quite unprecedented.
Yes, but we're not relying on the public to resolve this deadlock. We've built our case on the Constitution.
Yes, your interpretation of it.
Yes, quite.
But all that aside, I was wondering, perhaps I should try and effect a compromise.
Certainly, we'd think a negotiated settlement would be worth exploring.
Good. That does not mean that anything I say indicates that I agree or disagree with the stand taken by either side. I intend to keep my judgments to myself. It is purely an attempt to resolve a conflict.
Yes, I understand. It's an interesting suggestion, Sir John. We've certainly heard that Mr. Whitlam was thinking of a half-Senate election. Probably for Saturday, December the 13th.
His plans are that far advanced?
Well, the date's conjecture, but it would be the last day that such an election could be held before the Christmas vacation. He'd have to announce it on or about November the 11th.
Remembrance Day. Would you be prepared to pass it if he postponed it?
Just let me say, sir, that while there's a slim chance that such an election could give Labour a temporary majority, the more likely result is that it won't.
You're rejecting the proposal, then?
No, sir, not at all. I would just like to think about it. Discuss it with my senior colleagues.
Oh, of course, yes.
We've been concerned for some time that Mr. Whitlam may want to resort to a half-Senate election. Even then, he may not win a majority, and it's the consequences of that that particularly concern me. The country would then find itself in mid-December, the Houses of Parliament still deadlocked, the crisis unresolved. The government out of money.
A black Christmas indeed, Mr. Fraser.
It's about time you fellas realize the damage you're doing to our case and the party with your attitude.
Gentlemen.
I'll catch you later. How'd you go?
Kerr's come up with a compromise.
Any good?
Not really. It means we have to back down on a general election.
I think you should know. Some of our blokes are getting rattled. That's just a warning, Shorty, that's all.
Eileen, where's Phil?
I can't find him, sir.
Kerr suggested a compromise. We pass the budget, and Whitlam won't try to get a temporary majority. There'll be no half-Senate election.
What did you say?
We'd think about it.
It'd knock off any risk of an electoral redistribution.
That's a hell of a lot of agony just for that. What's your feeling, Malcolm?
Well, it's not what we've been after. It's like stalking a lion and coming back with a kitten.
I agree. I think we should reject it.
What I don't want to do is to appear intransigent. I think we should have an alternative, but one that includes an election for the House of Representatives.
Goodness me, I don't think Whitlam will agree to that.
No, nor do I.
Sorry, I got caught. I've been talking to a reporter. Whitlam's found a new way to fund the government. He says he's going to get the banks to give credit, and he says they'll advance money to public servants, contractors, and God knows who.
And then what?
Well, when the budget's finally passed, the government will repay the banks.
Is it legal?
Well, Whitlam says it is.
Find out.
Jesus, it could drag on for months.
It won't. It will be over in a matter of days. And in such a way that the country will never, ever forget. The 21st day of the constitutional crisis. 21 days of deadlock. The opposition refusing to fund the government refusing to call an election, and the Governor General keeps his own counsel.
Anxious to resolve the crisis, Sir John, but we're committed to a general election. We
the opposition would pass the budget tomorrow. Mr. Whitlam would guarantee an election within the next 6 months.
Yes, well, you know the Prime Minister's position. He says a general election is not negotiable.
Yes, I understand that, Sir John, but we're convinced that it's a reasonable and responsible proposal.
Well, I'm sure you do, but it doesn't change the complexity of the problem. What we have here is a labyrinth. Law, constitution, convention, precedent, political tactics. I wonder how much longer we can gamble with this country, with its economy, and the welfare of its people. I urge you to consider this very carefully.
We have, Sir John. We're convinced our stand is legitimate. We're determined to pursue it.
Yes. Yes, of course. Thank you. Can you see any resolution to it?
We think they're going to break. The intelligence we get indicates that several of their senators are buckling.
But that's only conjecture, isn't it?
Well, yes, but it's very strong. We're thinking in terms of a week, not much more. This is a detailed summary of the financial arrangements. It's pretty messy, but I think you'll agree it can work.
When are the government funds going to be exhausted?
We've definitely got supply until November the 30th. And with the economies we've instituted, at least till the second week in December, possibly longer. The Attorney General's department has checked it. It's legal.
Thank you. How do you think you would go in a general election?
I think we'd get done. A full campaign for both houses? I'm sure of it.
But Gough is a magnificent political animal, especially with his back to the wall. He's like a lion.
Maybe so, but it's a lot easier to get out than to get in.
But if he went out this time, he'd be back in a turn.
I don't think anyone can predict that.
I think you could.
Anyway, those are the financial arrangements. As I say, we believe it's both workable and legal.
Thank you.
I've just seen Kerr and I'm worried.
Why? What did he say?
Well, he was rambling on and then he started talking about how we'd go in an election. Well, call it what you like, a copper's instinct, but I reckon he's thinking of tossing us out.
Oh, no, Bill, no. I saw him this morning. I spoke to him about a half-centered election. He was fine.
Gough, I'm not sure.
You worry too much. It's good of you to call, but I've told you. He's all right. Believe me.
Yeah. Okay, well, you know him.
Though nobody knows it, the end game has just begun. But as fate would have it, there's a growing number of Liberals who are about to buckle.
I told them, anybody breaks now kisses their career goodbye.
What did they say?
Rattle on about national welfare.
Really? What about loyalty? Get them to think about that.
Loyalty's the only thing keeping them together.
I suppose I should be flattered.
No, not loyalty to you, Malcolm. Loyalty to the party.
Well, tell them the party expects them to stand firm. I must have more time.
I'm certain Kerr is going to intervene.
Malcolm's right. The walls are closing in on him.
Yeah, maybe. But we've been thinking.
What do you mean, we, Phil?
Well, Doug, Wedge and I, we reckon that you ought to keep pushing the idea of a compromise.
It would help settle things down. Buy us more time.
I see.
I've confirmed those dates, Your Excellency. The Chief Electoral Commissioner advises writs be issued by November 11th.
Tell me, what do the people want, David?
Sir?
What do they expect of a Governor General? Am I only here to do as I'm told? Or is my role more than that? I've tried compromise.
Yes, sir, you have.
Do I impose a solution? Is that it?
The people are worried, I know. The household staff are asking about their wages. I'm told public servants are anxious about their rent, mortgages.
Yes. Yes, one forgets.
Australian people want two things: political leaders who will resolve the crisis and a chance to cast their vote. Last week we suggested a compromise which would have ended the crisis. Mr. Whitlam rejected it. Nevertheless, we believe every avenue should be explored. We will now approach Mr. Whitlam in an attempt to organize an immediate meeting. Perhaps face-to-face, a rational and democratic solution can be found.
Does this mean...
When will the meeting take place?
I've written to Mr. Fraser indicating that 9 a.m. next Tuesday, November 11, would be convenient.
Mr. Fraser says any solution must include an election for the House of Representatives. Are you willing to negotiate on this basis?
The Prime Minister is the only one who can call an election, not the Leader of the Opposition. A House of Representatives election is just not on.
Does this mean that the meeting soon...
But they're determined to go ahead?
Oh, yes, they're determined. Not a day goes by they don't dig in deeper. Fraser told me today that he's given his final offer, while Whitlam huffs and puffs about an election being not negotiable.
And you think neither one will budge? Not even if you appeal to them for the sake of the country?
One thing that I've learned is politics has little to do with statesmanship. Even so, these politics have been reduced to a street brawl.
Well, how do they expect it to be resolved? Do we all just wait until one batters the other to death?
Well, Fraser keeps encouraging me to listen to the law. I must admit his attempts at subtlety are slightly more palatable than Whitlam's bluster. But nonetheless, he's made it clear that he wants me to act. Whitlam doesn't think I have the courage. You know, I really hoped that it would never come to this. But I swore an oath, and I'm bound by the Constitution.
I sometimes think perhaps history conspired to cast you here. If it did, it couldn't have chosen a better man.
Early on the morning of November the 10th, 1975, Sir John Kerr, despite the Prime Minister's directive, arranges to meet the Chief Justice of Australia, Sir Garfield Barwick. The Chief Justice, a former Attorney General in a Liberal government, is the double cousin of prominent Liberal politician Robert Ellicott.
I just wanted to make that clear.
Well, the situation is that I have decided
on a certain course of action. Now, what I would like you to advise me on is my course within my constitutional authority and duty.
That afternoon, the Chief Justice's written advice arrives. Sir Garfield makes two fundamental points. First, the Senate has the constitutional power to refuse to pass a budget. Second, a Prime Minister in such a position must either advise a general election or resign. Accordingly, he writes, the course upon which Your Excellency has determined is consistent with your constitutional duty. So silently, the crisis nears its flood, sweeping Kerr on relentlessly into history.
Dear Mr. Whitlam, in accordance with Section 64 of the Constitution, I hereby terminate your appointment as my chief advisor and head of the government.
Life is rich in irony, no less this last night. Edward Gough Whitlam and John Malcolm Fraser are together, the guests of honor at a Lord Mayoral banquet in Melbourne. As a result of the strict economies now being enforced by the government, travel arrangements for politicians have been severely curtailed. Whitlam offers Fraser a lift back to Canberra in the Prime Ministerial jet.
As it appeared likely that you would today persist in this attitude, I decided that if you did, I would determine your commission and state my reasons for doing so. It is with a great deal of regret that I have taken this step, both in respect of yourself and your colleagues. I propose to send for the leader of the opposition and to commission him to form a new caretaker government until an election can be held. Yours sincerely.
But Sir John doesn't sign the letter. He hopes the morning will bring a compromise. In Canberra, Remembrance Day 1975 dawns clear and bright. It is the 57th anniversary of the end of the Great War. At the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, the nations of the Western world will pause to honor the dead of all wars. Though it is known to one man only, the 92 members of the Australian Parliamentary Labour Party are already dead men running. At 9 a.m, the meeting arranged earlier in the week between Gough Whitlam and Malcolm Fraser begins.
What I want to know is this. Are you prepared to pass the budget bills immediately? If so, I am willing to defer a half-Senate election. In other words, the government will surrender any chance of getting a temporary majority.
Well, I suppose that's a start.
We understand that the Governor General raised the idea with you several days ago.
Yes, and we considered it then. We were quite adamant. Any solution must include an early election for the House of Representatives.
That surprises me. You gentlemen have been in Parliament long enough. You know the principles that are at stake here. You know that I can't agree to that.
You're quite sure it's not negotiable?
Quite sure.
Well, then I'm sorry, but I'm afraid a compromise is out of the question.
Then you leave me with no choice. I'll immediately advise a half-Senate election. Valerie, The Governor General, please.
They seem pretty cocky.
Oh, Prime Minister, good morning.
I'm sorry to trouble you, but I'd like to see you as soon as possible.
Did you have any success?
They're still demanding a general election. I told them I was willing to defer a half-Senate election, but they rejected that.
Well, there is no sign that they will pass the budget?
No, not at the moment. I now want to call on you and immediately set in train a half-Senate election.
Well, I am due at the Remembrance Day service at 11, but I shall be returning here.
Unfortunately, I'll be in the house then. It'll have to wait until the luncheon adjournment.
Yes. Thank you. Goodbye.
And still he doesn't sign the letter of dismissal. Still there's a chance for compromise.
Our Sydney town's potential to earn income is beyond doubt. Not only overseas visitors, but Australians too are fascinated by our convict past. The smell of rum, the clank of leg irons, the thought of a flogging, that's what people want.
Excuse me, Harry. Firstly, I would like to thank you all for the loyalty and devotion that you've shown over the past 3 weeks. Needless to say, this morning's meeting failed to find a compromise. So I have told the Governor General that I will be calling a half-Senate election. It will be fought on one issue and one issue only. Should a government be held to ransom by the Senate? And it will be our exquisite duty to ram that answer down their throats in terms they will never forget.
It's pretty ugly. If Whitlam forces a half-Senate, it could panic them. I can't guarantee they'll hold.
Oh, it's not just the faint-hearted. I've spoken to a lot of the fellas. They reckon we've overplayed our hand.
What can I say? Believe me, we've got to keep going. I don't care how you do it. I told you I didn't want to be interrupted.
I'm sorry, sir, but it's the Governor General.
Yes, Sir John?
I shan't keep you a moment now. I was just ringing about this morning's conflict.
No, sir, no progress yet, except that Mr. Whitlam has made it clear that he's going to advise a half-Senate election.
Yes, I know. I was just wondering, subsequently, if it has changed your position.
No, sir. No change.
And your policy is still the same?
Yes, we're determined to force an election for the House of Representatives.
I see. Thank you. Bye.
Look, I appreciate your concern. All Malcolm's asking for is a little more time.
What happened to the meeting this morning?
Malcolm will tell you that himself. Here he is. Everybody take your seats, will you, please? Now, I know the strain you're under. No one appreciates it more than I. I do believe a decision is a matter of hours away, perhaps even minutes away.
What's it going to be?
In the interim, I am opposed to any discussion on the crisis at all.
It's our right to be heard, Malcolm.
I know, but not now.
There are those of us who believe the situation's gone on far too long.
I'm appealing to you all. I insist. I am the leader of the party. You must trust me.
Hey, here.
Thank you.
No doubt.
Your car is waiting.
Thank you. The Prime Minister will be here at 1 when the House adjourns. You tell Mr. Fraser to come 10 minutes later.
Certainly, Sir John.
And so it's done. This thing that can never be undone. For the first time, the representative of the Crown has signed the documents which will dismiss an Australian Prime Minister. Parliament assembles at 11:45, immediately after the war memorial service. During the ceremony, Sir John has spoken only once to the government's representative. "Goodbye, Mr. Attorney General," he says. "It is indeed."
Get a message to him, please. The Governor General will be receiving the Prime Minister at the luncheon adjournment. He would be pleased to receive Mr. Fraser 10 minutes later. Thank you.
The Prime Minister does not understand the nature of Australian society. Other more compact societies see the need for federalism, for decentralization. He sees only the need for a gathering of power into his own hands. His centralist dreams are inappropriate and out of touch with the needs of this time, and his refusal to face the truth about Australia and its constitution is leading him deeper and deeper into unconstitutional action.
Order! The Honourable Member will remove the badge. Order! The Honourable Member will remove the badge.
Prime Minister. The Prime Minister has not said that he would accept the Governor General's decision taken in accordance with...
But when one considers the lengths the Leader of the Opposition is apparently prepared to go to damage Australia, to cause harm to innocent people, to delay or even destroy the chance of economic recovery, and in particular, the role he is playing in attempting to undermine the rights and powers of this House. This House of Representatives, this People's House, he is unfit to be the leader of the opposition.
Not now, Sergeant. I want you to ring the Chief Electoral Commissioner, Mr. Lay. Confirm with him that December the 13th is the last practical day for an election. Find out when writs have to be issued. What's the deadline? You also better check with him. Make sure he's in his office this afternoon. Ring my wife. Find out where she'll be in the next couple of hours. That's all, I think.
Good luck, sir.
Thank you.
In the strain of a crucial hour, even the best laid plans can go astray. Malcolm Fraser's staff miscalculate the movements of the Prime Minister. The Leader of the Opposition arrives first at Yarralumla. Should Gough Whitlam learn of it, he may realize.
You're early. I said Whitlam first.
The right time, as far as I'm concerned.
No, I'm
right
sorry,
time.
It's not here. Could you take the car around the back, please?
Yes, sir, we always park the car.
Don't argue. The anteroom, if you would, Mr. Fraser. Mm-hmm. Forgive me. Sir John will explain. What a lovely day it is.
Yes, it is.
Do sit down. Would you like a drink?
Thank you.
Scotch?
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me for one moment, sir.
And up.
John.
Prime Minister.
Thank you. I have a letter here with my advice.
Before you go on, I understand today's discussions failed to find a compromise.
To be expected.
Then you are not calling a general election.
No, I'm not.
Well, then I must inform you that I have decided to withdraw your commission.
Have you spoken to the palace?
I don't have to. And it is too late for you. I've terminated your commission. Here is a formal notice of my reasons. The Chief Justice agrees with my decision.
I advised you. I told you not to consult with him.
I tried to get a compromise. Anyway, good luck. We shall all have to live with this.
You certainly will.
This way, please, Mr. Fraser.
Sir John.
Mr. Fraser, please. Thank you.
It has been my duty to dismiss Mr. Whitlam. I am now in a position to commission you Prime Minister of Australia. But first, I must know if you can guarantee supply to your government.
Yes, Sir John, we can have the budget passed immediately.
I must inform you of certain conditions. You will be appointed in the capacity of caretaker until an election can be held for both Houses of Parliament. Now, can you advise such an election?
Yes, sir, I can, with pleasure.
Between now and polling day, would you guarantee to initiate no new policies, make no new appointments, and undertake no inquiries into the activities of the previous government?
I can guarantee that. I give my word.
Bearing in mind all that I've said, are you prepared to accept a commission as Prime Minister?
Yes, sir, I am.
Mr. Smith. Thank you. Will you, John Malcolm Fraser, please take the oath?
I, John Malcolm Fraser, do swear that I will well and truly serve Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, her heirs and successors according to law in the office of Prime Minister, so help me God.
these circumstances, I think we'll dispense with the champagne. Oh, no, please. Keep that as a memento. Prime Minister.
Thank you, Sir John.
Like any man wounded and shocked, Whitlam seeks refuge in his home. There he calls his colleagues, not yet telling them of the government's fate.
John. Yes. Now I'm at the lodge. You should tell Crane, Hayden, Freudenberg, Enderby, Scholes. Tell them I want him. Here, yes. Immediately.
Whitlam is to write 4 years later. The condemned man ate a hearty meal, although the normal order was reversed. I had my steak after the execution.
Well?
I'm Prime Minister.
Congratulations.
Call the electoral office. We're going to have an election. December 13th.
It's well done, Shorty.
But the government now. We need money. How long to pass the budget?
Give me 5 minutes.
Make it 4. Tammy? Gough's been sacked.
Light lunch, eh, Gough?
He sacked us.
What?
The bastard sacked us.
Luke. Well, what's happening? We've been sacked.
What do you mean, sacked?
Oh. But you can't do that. We've got a majority. To terminate the commission as Prime Minister Whitlam. Arrange for a caretaker government. Oh,
shit. Right.
Because of the principle of responsible government.
All right, then. Prime Minister, I mean, Gough, I think I should go. I serve the department, not the man. I can't stay.
You're quite right, John. I understand.
Thank you. Good luck, sir. It's been a privilege.
Chaos, the confusion, and the Labour Party senators left in ignorance. A messenger brings the news just as the budget bills are ready for debate.
It will be allowed to govern. The House of Representatives declares its concern that the unprecedented and obstructive stand taken by the Senate is undermining public confidence in our parliamentary system of government. The House of Representatives again calls upon the Senate.
He sacked us.
Pass the supply bills without further delay.
Are you going to move the bills, or shall we?
Not for them even the chance to plan a last-ditch stand.
I move that the bills be now passed. The question not been open to debate or amendment. I move that the question now be put.
All those in the affirmative say aye.
Aye.
Must we know? I think the ayes have it. The sitting of the Senate is suspended until the ringing of the bell.
Mr. Speaker, this afternoon the Governor General commissioned me to form a government until elections can be held.
Yeah. Go on, sit down.
The purpose of the commission is to permit a deadlock between the Houses of Parliament to be resolved and return Australia to stable government.
Yeah.
It will be the sole purpose to ensure that Australia has the general election to which it is constitutionally entitled, and to which it has so far been denied. My government will make no appointments or dismissals or initiate any new policies. I have written to the Governor General in these terms. Your Excellency, you have intimated to me that it is Your Excellency's pleasure that I should act as your chief advisor and head of government. In accepting your commission, I confirm that I have given you an assurance that I shall immediately seek to secure the passage of the supply bills, which are at present before the Senate.
You've only got a pack of political backstabbers.
Thus ensuring the supply for the carrying on of public service in all its branches. I further confirm on the granting of supply, I shall immediately recommend, Your Excellency, the dissolution of both Houses of Parliament.
I don't know whether you've heard. Fraser's advised an election. Both houses, December the 13th. It'll be a short campaign, 4 weeks. Most of the rest of us have packed ourselves up. I chartered a plane, sent it all back home. Gough, there's a crowd gathering outside. They're calling for you.
go down in Australian history from Remembrance Day 1975 as Kerr's Kerr.
And lest we should ever forget, there is violence in the streets this Remembrance Day. Throughout Australia, those who had waited 20 years for a Labour government march in protest. In cities and towns, police leave is cancelled, workers down tools, Liberal Party offices are stoned, and fights erupt in city streets. For a moment, it seems, the very fabric of Australian society may unravel. So begins the federal election campaign of 1975. A campaign in which Gough Whitlam makes no new promises, gives no new undertakings. He speaks simply of a crisis in democracy, of a great wrong that must be righted.
Men and women of Australia, the whole future of Australian democracy is in your hands.
Malcolm Fraser hammers inflation and unemployment. Taking as his theme the three dark years, he calls on Australia to turn on the lights. Day by day, the shadow cast by the dismissal fades. The economy emerges as the only issue. In the election held on December the 13th, Malcolm Fraser wins the biggest majority in Australian political history. And that was the way of it. In Australia, in the spring of 1975, some things lost, some things found. But the years slip by. John Malcolm Fraser, Frazier Nareen Victoria, remained Prime Minister until his defeat at the election of March the 5th, 1983. He resigned the Liberal leadership late that night. Edward Gough Whitlam was once again rejected at the federal election held on December the 10th, 1977. Within months, he resigned from both the Labour leadership and the Parliament. He is now elder statesman of his party, academic, advocate of the Australian Republic. The leadership passed to Bill Hayden, who in 1980 came within 2% of the prime ministership. 3 years later, he himself resigned as opposition leader. On January the 1st, 1978, Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, on the recommendation of Malcolm Fraser, created Billy Mackey Snedden Knight Bachelor. For 7 years, he was the Speaker of the House of Representatives, a position he discharged with great distinction. In October 1977, Dr. James Ford Cairns did not seek re-election. A thoughtful man, approaching his 70th year, he strives to raise our consciousness. Accompanied by Junie Morosi, he explores alternative lifestyles. For some men, life itself is fed by nothing more than dreams. Midway through 1977, after almost 30 years as a politician, Rex Connor announced he would resign from Parliament. He died several weeks later. They buried him, late in the afternoon, in a simple grave not far from Wollongong Collieries. His dream of Australian resources, owned by Australians, remains just that, a dream. In New York, in the winter of 1980, Tirath Hasaram Kemlani was arrested and charged with trafficking in stolen securities. Although he was sentenced to 3 years in a federal penitentiary, he was immediately released on parole. Present whereabouts unknown. John Robert Kerr, Governor General of Australia, retired from viceregal office in December 1977. The man who wrote often of his love for Australia lives in self-imposed exile in Surrey, England. The Australian Constitution, which allowed the events of Remembrance Day 1975 to occur, remains unchanged. A precedent now exists for a man elected by no one to dismiss a government elected by the Australian people. And so it goes. The tide of events bears us on, ceaselessly into the future. But as all men learn, it's those who forget the past that are bound to relive it.